My background, I'm actually, well, remote background, I'm Lebanese Maronite. I don't know where I really fit because I'm too Australian to be Lebanese and too Lebanese to be Australian, so I've always been somewhere in the middle. I like to think that we take the best from everything. There is that Melkite element there because my wife, even before I met her, had a very strong devotion to, has a very strong devotion to St. Elias. This is why my first son is called Elias. And she had regular attendance at the Melkite Church and the one in particular, Guildford. So we've gone often to the Guildford, the St. Elias of Guildford there to worship. And I haven't done that much in the last 12 months, but nevertheless, it's something that's really a part of our lives. I actually used to come to this parish on a semi-regular basis 20 to 25 years ago. That's why I remember Moira when I saw Moira when I was born. Sorry, I don't want to reveal too much there, but I remember you were the secretary of the Bishop Rieschi at the time. And so that was my early links to this particular parish. The topic tonight is called Prophets of Doom, and I thought about this, well, what emphasis am I going to give to it? It's very Old Testament related, so I'm going to spend quite a bit of time on the Old Testament and give it, you know, speak about some of the great prophets that we read about in the Old Testament. But I thought, look, you have to make this relevant. And actually, one of you asked me just before we started, you know, is this going to be talking about just the Old Testament prophets? And I said no, because we have to relate it to today, because that's what the question asks. Prophets of doom, should we listen to them? And the motivation of this talk, going back about maybe 3 or 4 years ago, was not necessarily to give an outline of the prophets and their history in the Old Testament, but really to counter a certain mentality that I saw among very close friends of mine and some elements of, you know, the Lebanese Maronite community, which rightfully looks at the world with great concern, but overreacts and tends towards pessimism and the bunker mentality. So that's what I was intending to address. That when we look at the world today and all its problems, its enormous problems, we certainly need prophets, absolutely. And we even need prophets of doom. I mean, the term prophets of doom comes from Amos, prophet to Israel in the late 8th century BC. He was a prophet of doom, and he spoke the truth. So we need prophets, and we need prophets even of doom, but we need to know how to respond adequately in the world. And that's the theme I'm going to develop, hopefully, in the second half of tonight. So I will go and delve into a little bit of history of prophets and some examples of Old Testament prophets, because their stories are very exciting and very inspirational, absolutely. The word prophet, Nabi, is what we say in Arabic, and that has its origins in Hebrew and the Torah. Nabi, prophet. And when we think of prophets, the common popular understanding of a prophet is someone who speaks and predicts about the future. Prophesy. Tell us something about the future. I guarantee you, that's what we get very excited about, that idea, don't we? And you don't have to be religious to get excited about that idea. We all want to know about the future. You know, we've heard it said, if I had tomorrow's newspaper today, 24 hours in advance every day, I'll be making a fortune. If I could, you know, bet on the right horse in the horse races, and I can, you know, invest in the right shares, and et cetera, et cetera. So we all want to know about the future. So when we think about prophets, we think about, normally we think about someone who's going to tell us about the future, predict the future for good or for ill, etc. But it's much broader than that. Absolutely much broader than that. And prophets, authentic prophets, yes, many of them did speak about the future, did make predictions about Israel, about Judah, about the geopolitical world in general. When we look at Daniel and the various kingdoms that will come and pass in succession, particularly over in the Middle Eastern world. And prophecies, of course, concerning the coming of the Messiah, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus Christ. Yes, but many authentic prophets also did not predict the future, because to be a prophet is more than predicting the future. In ancient Israel, prophets were one of the three great pillars, three great institutional pillars, if you could say so. There were the kings in the line of David, and there was the priesthood, and there were the prophets. And when we even look at Jesus, he was all three in one. When he said, and according to the Gospel of John, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, he was summing up everything about Israel, all those three institutions, those three pillars of Israel in himself. Because the kings were the government, and they show us the way. The prophets spoke the truth, and Jesus was the greatest teacher of truth. The way, the truth, and the life. And the priesthood gave the people of Israel the life, the spiritual life. Out of those three institutions, when you read the Old Testament, I have to admit, I've only ever read the Old Testament once in my life, from go to right. I've read many parts of the Old Testament many times, but from front to back cover of the Old Testament, I only have done it once systematically. And I was shocked when I read it. As a mature person in my mid-40s, or I think late 40s at the time, of the levels of corruption in ancient Israel, among the kings and among the priests. And I realised, and reading other books and other authors, that that pillar of Israel, which had the greatest level of integrity, and which were, the members of which were most faithful to their calling and their mission, were the prophets. At the same time, I say there were many false prophets. But those who were genuinely called by Yahweh, by God, for a special mission either to Israel as a whole, or Israel the northern kingdom, or Judah the southern kingdom, or in the post-exilic period after they returned from Babylon, they are the most faithful to their calling. There were good priests, but there were many bad ones. And there were good kings, but there were many bad ones. And of the authentic prophets, they were, in the vast majority, faithful to their mission. In general, to sum up, what is a prophet is a person who was called, male or female. There was no limit on gender, and there was no limit on what their pre-original vocation was. They were to be the mouthpieces of God. They are simply to proclaim the will of God to the people of God at that particular time. That's the core mission of a prophet. And a prophet was generally categorized as a traditionalist, as a conservative. Now, I don't like those terms because they can be political. But they weren't men or women, mostly men, and a number of women. They weren't people who introduced novelties necessarily. They were sent on mission to the people of God in order to call them back to the original covenant with God, with Yahweh. And because these prophets were speaking about after the time of Moses, they were calling the people back to fidelity with the covenant made between Yahweh and Moses. So that's why I say they were traditionalists. Come back, because the people had gone astray, and we'll see what type of stray they engaged in over the centuries in which the prophets had to grapple with. A person called to be a prophet, as I said, could have been anyone from any category. I'll give you some examples. Eliseus, who was the successor to Elijah, was originally a farmer. Amos was a shepherd. Isaiah was a nobleman, educated. Jeremiah and Ezekiel were priests. And as I said already, there were women who were called as well. I'll give you the names of Miriam, of Deborah, of Huldah as three examples of female prophets. Prophets generally were very conscious of their mission, of their call. Very conscious of how they were called. Hearing the voice of God was seen as theophany, that is a manifestation of God, like Isaiah when he's praying in the temple, And suddenly, as a very young man, that opens up this great vision of Yahweh being worshipped by the cherubim singing, "Holy, holy, holy." So they're very conscious of having received a vision or having heard a voice, and very conscious of their particular call and what mission they are called to do. They are conscious of their unworthiness. For example, like Jeremiah, "I'm too young, who's going to listen to me?" Even Moses, back 8 centuries before Jeremiah, was conscious of his speech impediment. But they were also, they exhibited that consciousness, their awareness of their mission in how they spoke. "Thus says the Lord," or "the Lord God says," or "Yahweh says," and that's how they spoke. They always spoke in the name of God, of Yahweh, of the one who called them. Now you should notice here a distinction between these prophets and how Jesus spoke. Because Jesus, more often than not, spoke in his own name. "You've heard Moses say, but I say to you." When Jesus did miracles, he didn't say in the name of God, in the name of Yahweh, in the name of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, "I say to you, arise." He didn't speak like that. He said, "Damsel, I say to you, arise. Lazarus, come forth." Jesus was a prophet, but he was more than a prophet, and exhibited his greater than prophet status in the way he spoke, because he was the authority. Yes, he was sent from the Father, he was sent on the greatest of all missions, but he was also God incarnate, which is why he spoke in his own name and did miracles in his own name. Now, prophets were different categories in Israel. There were prophets who worked in the temple, now professional prophets. They actually got paid for their work. There were prophets who hung around the court, and they're the ones who probably most likely would have been, more often than not, false prophets. And you can tell a false prophet from an authentic prophet among those that worked around the court, because the false prophets would more likely than not be giving positive advice to the king, telling the king what the king wanted to hear, rather than what he should have heard. The authentic prophets practice what we say in Greek, parhesia, that is, an open defiance, if you could say it. That's probably putting it too strongly, but speaking audaciously and courageously in front of the legitimate authority, to tell that authority often what they did not want to hear, what would not please them. And they were the free prophets. The free prophets are those who weren't assigned at the temple or worked around the court, but they are those great ones that we know, like Isaiah, like Jeremiah, like Ezekiel, like Daniel, like some of the other prophets, the minor prophets, who were out there, Elijah especially, Eliseus, who were out there in the wild, in the countryside, traveling from place to place, or being pursued, etc., or in hiding. They stood at the margins of society, often as observers of what was happening, and speaking out against that. Okay, now I've got some more information here. I've got a list of 18 official male prophets. And they've broken up in these three general periods, from Moses to Elijah. That's around the 15th century BC to the 9th century BC, that 600-year period. Then we've got the literary prophets from Amos onwards. So Amos is 8th century BC, and we go to Jeremiah, Daniel, and Ezekiel, which is 6th century BC. And that was a very, very traumatic time in the history of Israel and Judah, where God raised up very powerful empires, Assyria and then Babylon, to be, they were powerful and evil empires, pagan, worship many gods, but were raised up by Yahweh to be instruments of chastisement upon Israel and Judah because of their failure to listen to the prophets that were sent to them and to repent and come back to fidelity with the law of Moses. Now, understand here, God, Yahweh, the Old Testament God, is the same New Testament God. It's the same God of Jesus Christ. So that it's the same God of love and mercy, but we read about this God often chastising, punishing the Old Testament. Not to harm them, but for their betterment, for their good. Because if they were allowed to keep going down the wrong path, it would be a path of self-destruction. And no good parents would allow their children to go down the path of self-destruction. If you see God punishing even his own people in Old Testament, when you read the Old Testament, it's for their own good. And you have to understand what's at stake here. When you read the Old Testament, read it as a collection of books that is preparing for the coming of the Messiah. When you read about the people of God, when you read about the children of Abraham, the call of Abraham, and the next 2,000 year period, that's all about that call of that people, the formation of that people, the preparation of that people, the preservation of that people, is all for the sake of the coming of the Messiah, what we call the coming of the Incarnation. If, in God's original plan, if this people that he calls, forms, call the 12 tribes and then the remnant, Judah, that one tribe, Judah against the Jews, if they are totally lost in apostasy, if they are totally corrupted, if they totally go after false gods, the pagan gods, and they disappear as Yahweh's children, and Israel and Judah disappear as the spouse of Yahweh, then God's plan for the incarnation and the salvation of humanity is frustrated. And that's what's at stake here. And that's why it was necessary at all costs to preserve this people who were being formed, not for their own sake and their own glory, so that one day the Jews would dominate the world because they were the only followers of the true God. But they are being formed for the sake of the salvation of the whole of humanity. And that's why it was necessary at all costs to preserve them until the incarnation would take place. And the last category of the latter prophets is that period after the Jews have returned from exile in Babylon around 515 BC. And we're talking about prophets like Zechariah and Malachias. And then there's this big gap, about 400 years, until John the Baptist. This is what we need to understand. When God gives a name, he gives it for a purpose. And the name was to reflect that person's mission, their calling, their vocation. So Abraham becomes Abraham because exalted father is now to become the father of many peoples. And Jacob becomes Israel because that is to denote that this people who will be the sons of Jacob will be always struggling with God. He who fights with God. That's what Israel means. And Mary, the angel doesn't greet Mary, oh, Hail Mary. He doesn't say that. It says, Hail, thou who hast been graced. Because that's her name, according to the angel Gabriel, because that denoted what she was in her person. And Simon becomes Peter because he's now going to be the rock, the foundation on which Jesus will build his church. So names are very important. They have meaning. So if you're going to have children in the future, any of us, I'm sure some of us look like we have that potential still, you give them a name that reflects something about God, about our Christian faith, about your Melkite heritage, etc. Okay. Right, so, what else can we say? What do you think were some of the things that prophets were concerned about in ancient Israel? What do you know about the Old Testament, some of the problems that Israel had? Israel and Judah.
Marriage.
What do you say specifically about marriage?
They didn't want them to marry.
Intermarriage with people who are not Hebrews or not Jews. Okay? Yes, because the threat of that dilutes the family, dilutes the culture, imports foreign gold. That was Solomon's downfall. I mean, Solomon's an interesting case. Really? I don't want to laugh, but how do you handle 700 married women? And yeah, so how do you handle 700 wives? Full respect to the women here, you know. Women ask, how do you handle any man? Fair enough. How do you handle 700 wives plus 300 concubines on the side? Many of them were imported pagan women, and Solomon allowed them to worship their gods and imported that paganism, that idolatry into Israel. Intermarriage is a big problem. What other problem was there?
Idolatry.
Idolatry, yeah, falling for other gods. You see, here's an example. I don't know most Melkites if you see yourselves as Lebanese or Syrian, but it really doesn't matter here. Because up north of Israel is Phoenicia and Arab. Arab and Assyria, hence Aramaic, from the language they spoke. Now, the predominant deities in those regions were the Canaanite deities, the Baalic divinities, Baal worship. Huge problem. Huge problem. Because this people, the Hebrews, are essentially agricultural. They wanted the seasons to tick over, and they wanted the rains to come at the right time every year, and the sun to come at the right time every year. Their crops depended on it. If the rains failed, the crops failed, everything's at stake. Now, the Baalic divinities were fertility gods. One of them was called Haddad, very unfortunately. I went to see Archbishop Coleridge once, the Archbishop of Brisbane. This was back in 2009. I visited him in his office. I had to do it by work. And he said, Haddad, the god of lightning. I said, yeah, lightning and thunder, rain, storms, rain for crops. And I said, how do you know that? I'm a biblical scholar. And he is, knows the Old Testament. So I don't want to tell people that often, but Haddad, it means smith, really, blacksmith. But then there was one of the Baalic divinities. And you know, you can see these divinities, little statues everywhere. You still dig them up all over the place in Phoenicia and Italy. They put these little statues at the corners of their farms. And they're hoping in Baal will bring the rains and bring fertility, not just to their crops, but to their flocks. This Yahweh God, okay, granddad worshipped him, but you know, we're more modern now. You know? We're more trendy and technological, up with it. The latest trends is the Baalic divinities. You know, you've got to have good relationships with our Phoenician trading partners. You import their gods, you know. Okay, we're building bridges here, you see. And so we can't see this Yahweh anyway. Who knows what was Moses thinking 500 years ago, 600 years ago? Moses is ancient history to these guys in the 9th century. But this idolatry was a huge problem. Phoenicia was a huge problem because Baalic divinities also asked for child sacrifice. And there will be Israelite kings right up until the 6th century BC, for hundreds of years, would dabble in Baalic worship and child sacrifice. Okay, you know some of the big problems. And the prophets were concerned about the contemporary big problems. And that's why, to relate this to today, I could spend the rest of the night relating our problems today in contemporary society. Then ask the question, where are the prophets today? Where are they? And ask them, and if you identify them, will I then move to see how well accepted are they? What's their message and how well are they accepted? Because if they're, I would say this just jumping the gun here, if their message is positive, and they're cheered on by the world, then be suspicious. That's all I need to say. What were some of the problems in ancient Israel? General injustice, corrupt judges, corrupt kings, corrupt businessmen. You know, you see, you hear, you read in the Old Testament, you know, one of the big crimes in the Old Testament was rigging the scales. Because when you buy and sell, it's according to weight. And if you're rigging the scales, you're stealing, you're ripping off your customers. Apostasy, Baal worship, we already mentioned that. Warnings against the nations, the influence of the surrounding nations, Egypt, Moab, Edom, Aram, Phoenicia. And later on, you know, the Hellenist influence, when Alexander the Great came across, but that was later. But it's always going to be a problem. Formalism and immorality. Imagine, what's formalism? The priest who does everything right, does the sacrifices right. One thing that's very tedious about reading the Old Testament is all the sacrifices, the types of sacrifices, and how they were to do the sacrifices. So if I'm a priest, and I'm not talking about priests in general, I'm talking about the corrupt ones. If I'm a priest, I'm doing all the sacrifices right, perfect according to the book, at the altar. Everything's right and proper, but in my heart there's hatred, there's jealousy, there's adultery, there's murder, there's hypocrisy, there's theft. That's formalism. I'm doing all the externals right, but the heart is not right. Against false alliances, like Jeremiah was very big on this. Jeremiah said, in this way he was hated, don't fight Babylon, you will be defeated. He knew the king was entering into alliances. Judah's small, but we've got Moab, we've got Edom, we've got Aram, we've got Egypt. We form an alliance, we'll be able to fight off Babylon. Jeremiah said, you're delusional. Egypt will not come. Egypt are the crocodile. They will not come to help. You have to trust in Yahweh if you're going to fend off Babylon. You have to return to Yahweh. Don't just think, oh, you got the temple, you'll never be destroyed. That's superstition. You're going to be destroyed unless you submit to Babylon and be faithful to Yahweh. That's why he was hated. This submission to Babylon is treachery. But they formed those alliances. And they are defeated, and they are crushed, and they are annihilated. What happened to Judah? The temple was destroyed. The presence of Yahweh in the temple departed forever. The Ark of the Covenant was destroyed. The people were enslaved in three deportations that sent into exile into Babylon. Those who escaped went to exile in Egypt, down the Nile to Ethiopia, all different parts of the Middle Eastern world. It was a total catastrophe because they trusted in alliances with pagan nations rather than Yahweh. Let's relate that to the 20th century. When Our Lady appeared at Fatima in 1917, she warned about the rise of communism and the Soviet Union as an atheist power. And said, if you want to avoid being punished by this power, you have to pray the rosary, do devotion to the first five Saturdays, and consecrate Russia, the Pope and the Bishop of the world united to him. But what did the Western world do? Went the other way. Yeah, we beat Nazi Germany with our own armies. And how are we going to fight off Russia afterwards, the Soviet Union, and stop the spread of communism? Through our own armies, military alliances, NATO, ANZUS, you name it. Then we had wars in Korea, and wars in Vietnam, etc. And it never stopped communism. Similar problem, and the same mistakes in the 20th century as it was back in the 6th century BC. What are other things that prophets warned against? False prophets? False prophet took money as well. Not only said what the king wanted to hear, not only had too much optimism, but took money for it. Then prophets spoke about medicinal punishments, chastisements. God will punish, but not to destroy, but to purify and to preserve. That's why Amos was called prophet of doom. There were prophets of consolation and hope, like Isaiah. Isaiah foresaw what was coming, but also foresaw the Messianic age. The coming of John the Baptist in Isaiah chapter 40. The coming of the Messiah in chapter 53. And then we have those prophets who spoke about the remnant, the faithful remnant. Elias, Jeremiah, Zechariah. And Jeremiah also spoke about a new and eternal covenant. Where do you hear the word new or new eternal, new everlasting covenant? Where do you hear about it? Where do you hear it every day?
In Mass.
In Mass. Particularly in the Roman Rite, when the priest consecrates the wine. This is the blood of the new and everlasting, or the new and eternal covenant shed for you and for all for the remission of sins. Do this in memory of me. That was foretold by Jeremiah, the coming of a new and eternal covenant. And that is the Christian faith, and that is the sign of that is the Eucharist. That's another talk. Okay. Have a look at the time. Now, do you mind if I... The rest of the next set of my notes relates to three prophets in particular. I might just do one, and then we'll see how we go. And then I'm going to talk about the contemporary sin, looking at the time of God. It's only 8:05, so still got a bit of time. Which prophet do you want to hear about? Do you want to hear about Elijah or Jeremiah in detail?
Jeremiah.
Which hand up if you want Elijah? One. Two, three, four, okay, they're rolling in. Which hand up you want Jeremiah? Sorry to the Elijah faction. The prophets warned against faction and division. Okay. All right. I could do both, but you put the ask for Jeremiah. So Jeremiah, this is one of my favorite times in the history of Judah and Israel. It's a time of the geopolitical and the religious coming together. The background here, the remote background, is that the Assyrian Empire rises slowly, but by the 8th century and the late 8th century, it's reached its height, superpower height. The Assyrians were ruthless. They are the Nazis of the ancient world.
Assyrians.
You're right. Thank you. Assyrians. Correct. All right. The Assyrians. They, and that's why when you, and the Jews were aware of this, and that's why you have the story of Jonah going to Nineveh. Why would Jonah go to Nineveh? Nineveh symbolizes the great enemy of the people of God. And I don't want to go to preach to Nineveh, because I want them to be punished. I want them to be destroyed by God, not saved, because they're that evil, they deserve to be destroyed. That's how Jonah was thinking. Assyria, when it conquered the land, ripped out the peoples that were conquered and then sent them into exile on the other side of the Euphrates. They practiced ethnic cleansing. And then they ripped out another people and they replaced them and they put them in their spot. That's where the Samaritans came from. The Samaritans were brought to that part of the world, the west bank of the Jordan River, and hence Samaria was formed, because the Assyrians put them there. The Assyrians came and destroyed Israel in 722 BC. And Isaiah was the prophet at that time. And Israel and Assyria got the 10 tribes and ripped them out and scattered them to the other side of the Euphrates, and only remnants of those tribes survived. Most of those peoples eventually dispersed, intermarried, and became other peoples in Asia. And then, of course, Assyria decided, we're going to go further south, we're going to take Judah as well. And they besieged Judah, Jerusalem, in 701 BC. How was Judah saved? Isaiah was still the prophet. He was alive. And he told the king, Hezekiah, what to do, to trust. And he did. And they trusted in Yahweh and not in alliances and foreign powers. And hence what happened when the Assyrian general Sennacherib came with 180,000 men and trapped the Jews in Jerusalem, encircled them. God sent one angel and completely destroyed that army. All the soldiers were blinded in one hit. and they had to withdraw. The Assyrian history records record their besieging Jerusalem, but don't record how they left Jerusalem. They never conquered Jerusalem because the king listened to Isaiah. Moving forward, though, there would be a terrible king in Judah called Manasseh. And Manasseh ruled for over 50 years, and he completely corrupted Judah. He fell into Baal worship. He even sacrificed his own son to the god Baal. And there were many injustices and corruptions and idolatry in the time of Manasseh as king. This is when Jeremiah rises. He's 18 years old when he's called. And he knows he's too young. But he's reassured by Yahweh that, you know, God has known him since the time he was conceived in his mother's womb, and that he's been called to this mission and not to have fear. And Jeremiah was fearless, and his mission work would be for many decades. Jeremiah was preaching. He had his supporters. They'll be going around Judah destroying pagan altars, destroying these pillars that were used, they were really phallic symbols, that were used because that's a symbol of fertility. And he was trying to purge Israel at a local ground level of false worship, of idolatry. There came to power a young king eventually called Josiah. And he came to power at a very young age, only 9 years of age. And he ruled for the next 31 years. And he was a great supporter of Jeremiah. It wasn't always the case, it was more often than not that the kings did not support these prophets. But in Josiah, Jeremiah had a great supporter. So he had this alliance of king and prophet to purify Israel, to Judah, sorry, to be more specific. And they made a lot of progress. And this progress for reform was accelerated when they were renovating the temple. This is the first temple of Solomon, which is now nearly 350 to 400 years old in construction and needed repair. And as they were repairing it, they found a copy of the book of Deuteronomy hidden in the nave in the wall. This book had been lost. When they read it, the priest and the king, they were terrified at what they were not doing. This is what I had the quote somewhere. This is what Josiah said when he read this book, rediscovered the book of Deuteronomy. Great is the wrath of the Lord because our fathers have not obeyed this book. And that was in the year 622. Now, the years went on. Go forward another 13 years. And what's happening? We'll go forward to we move now from 622 BC to 616 BC. What's happening? There's a revolt in Assyria. Assyria had Babylon under its domination, but Babylon revolted, and Babylon then became a power within the Assyrian kingdom, like a cancer eating it from within. And in a series of great battles between the Assyrians and the Babylonians from 616 to 612 to 606 BC, eventually the Babylonians overcame the Assyrians. But just before the Babylonians triumphed, destroyed the Assyrian kingdom, and became the great superpower of that part of the world, the Egyptians, under their pharaoh Necho, saw an opportunity to exploit the situation. If Assyria was falling apart, then Assyria's domination of Phoenicia and Israel in the north was slipping. They withdraw soldiers to defend their own homeland. So the Egyptians decided they will seize Judah, Israel, Phoenicia, and reincorporated into their kingdom as it used to be centuries before. So they invaded. And Josiah said, this is now 609 BC, Josiah said, no, we're not going to allow this. We're not going to exchange one tyranny for another. So Josiah led an army of Jews to fight the invading Egyptians, and that was at the Battle of Megiddo. I was at Megiddo last year in 609 BC, and tragically in this battle, Josiah, at the age of 40 years of age, died. And Jeremiah lost his great support. The next king was useless. The Egyptians won, and they set up a puppet king in Judah called Jehoiakim. And Jehoiakim was corrupt, unfaithful, and had absolute contempt for Jeremiah. And Jeremiah would prophesy in his presence, he'd be mocked. Jehoiakim would seek the death of this, and others, false prophets and courtiers and sycophants, would seek the death of this prophet Jeremiah, because he was preaching against the king and preaching submission to Babylon. When there were agitators who wanted to be free of Babylonian and Egyptian influence and power through force of arms. Well, anyway, one occasion, Jeremiah had a secretary called Baruch, and Baruch would write down the prophecies of Jeremiah, and they'll be sent to Jehoiakim, and they'll be read in his presence. He'll be given a copy, and the herald will be reading the same another copy, and Jehoiakim, while the herald is reading the prophecy of Jeremiah, will be just tearing it strip by strip in his face to show his contempt for Jeremiah. Well, what happens? Babylon is now the superpower and wanting to expand further. So it's putting pressure on Judah. It doesn't invade Judah straight away, but forces Judah into vassal status, which means we won't invade, but you've got to pay us tribute. You've got to pay us money every year, protection money, and we won't invade. And they were doing that for a number of years, but eventually the war party in Judah said, we've got to stop this, and we'll fight, and we will win, because we have Yahweh present among us in the Holy of Holies, in the temple in Jerusalem. Now, Jerusalem was saved before under the time of Isaiah and Hezekiah. We'll be saved by Yahweh again, don't worry. And this is where Jeremiah is preaching the following. I mend your ways and your doings, and I will let you dwell in this place. He's repeating the words of Yahweh. Do not trust in these deceptive words. This is the temple of the Lord. So Jeremiah is saying, You're not going to be protected because of this presumption. You think you've got the temple and the presence of Yahweh among you, that you're going to be saved. And you're not going to certainly be protected if you think you're going to have military alliances with these pagan powers that surround us. You're only going to be protected if you return to fidelity to the law of Moses. And he was ignored. And in the midst of being ignored, Jeremiah prophesied, Babylon will descend upon you, and you will be sent into exile for 70 years. And there were the first stirrings of revolt. Judah revolted in the year 597 against Babylon. Why listen to Jeremiah? He's a freak, he's a lunatic, he's an extremist, and he's a madman. And so, you know, we went into this revolt against Babylon, but what did we get? Babylon punished us and took 30,000 prisoners. 30,000 of our people, and sent them into exile into Babylon. One of those exiles was actually Ezekiel, one of the great prophets of hope who will be in Babylon, who was planted there and will be a prophet, a voice of hope for the future those exiles and the future exiles which were to come. Then we had the next revolt. Jehoiakim is gone. And now we have Zedekiah as king. So the next revolt is 594 BC. Jeremiah warns King Zedekiah to submit to Babylon or be destroyed. This planned second revolt comes out fully in the year 587 BC for the full-scale revolt of Judah and the smaller states in alliance against Babylon. And Nebuchadnezzar felt he was the king of Babylon. He was really peeved because he thought, you know, I could have destroyed you 10 years earlier. I'll let you off the hook, I'll let you off lightly. And what did you do? You backstabbed me. You've gone into revolt again. Well, this time I'm going to really punish you. So Babylon descends upon Judah, upon Jerusalem, upon the temple, and destroys everything. You have to understand the level of catastrophe here for the Jews. The sacred city of Jerusalem is ravaged. The temple that stood for the time of Solomon is destroyed. The Ark of the Covenant is taken and lost. Book of Maccabees said Jeremiah takes it and hides it in the cave. It's lost forever. The people are enslaved, and 90,000 are deported to Babylon. Many other thousands scatter in different directions. Jeremiah goes westward to Egypt. The Babylonians let Jeremiah off because they knew he was preaching submission to Babylon. He's killed in Egypt. He's killed by other Jews who saw him as a traitor. Ezekiel, by the way, is in Babylon, and what does he see? He sees in a vision the destruction of the temple. Ezekiel saw in a vision the glory presence of Yahweh leave the temple, leave the Holy of Holies, and go to a mountain in the east and ascend into heaven from there. That mountain was Mount Olivet. Ezekiel saw the glory presence of Yahweh ascend into heaven from Mount Olivet. Now, what do you think that's similar to? Who?
Christ.
Now, this is another talk, by the way. The temple will be rebuilt after they will begin to rebuild the temple 70 years later under Zerubbabel, Nehemiah. When they rebuild that temple, it's nothing like the original Temple of Solomon, which was grand and glorious and ornamented and artworks and statues and curtains and whatever. It was mediocre. The old men who were boys who remembered the Temple of Solomon before it was destroyed would weep at the second temple. But what was worse in the second temple is that it had no Ark of the Covenant. It had no glory presence. There was no Shekinah Kavod present in the Holy of Holies. So when the high priest went into the Holy of Holies to do their sacrifices on the feast of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, he wasn't doing it in the presence of the glory. There was no glory present. There was no ark. Okay? What happens now is that Jeremiah is dead. The Jews are substantially in exile in Babylon. And all seems lost. But Jeremiah had prophesied that they'll be there for 70 years. He told the Jews, look, settle down, get married, have kids, set up businesses, because you're going to be in Babylon for a long time, 70 years. But you'll be back, and the prophets in Babylon were the prophets of hope, Ezekiel and Daniel. And Daniel's prophecies of hope would extend right to the future, 500 years into the future, to the coming of the Messiah. Okay, now we look at the time. Oh, it shouldn't be long, maybe 10, 15 minutes and then we'll finish. What relevance does this have to today? I've just spoken really ancient history. You need to go to the Holy Land. Who's been to the Holy Land? Rwanda's been 15 times. They still hold you up. I'll embarrass Rwanda, but it's a nice embarrassment. I went with Rwanda to the Holy Land in 2013 with a teacher group, 40 teachers from Sydney Catholic Schools office, and I didn't know Rhonda then. And Rhonda was appointed by Cosmos, no, sorry, Harvest, delete that, Harvest, okay, to be our guide. And so we're going into Holy Land via the Galilee, Northern Gate. And anyone with a Middle Eastern background got a severe vetting. Is that the term these days? Vetting, severe vetting. And were held up for hours. Now, I can understand me being held up and some of the other teachers being held up. They're good. There was this one girl named Catherine, she's blonde. You wouldn't know she was Syrian background. No, quite Syrian. She's blonde. You look at her, you think she's an Aussie from Western Suburbs. And they picked her up. And they made her wait for hours. Anyway, what got me is that Rhonda's there for the 15th time, and she knows all these Israeli security officers by name. They're friends. Hi, Rhonda, good to see you again. But they made her wait 4 hours. I didn't get it. Okay, anyway, back on prophets. Okay. What was I saying? Yeah, you've got to go to the Holy Land because you've got to see this. I'm saying the point I'm making is that this is ancient history, but it comes alive when you're there. You can hear this talk, and you can read the Bible and do that, but it comes alive, it becomes in flesh when you're there. You need to go there one day. And I don't worry about the politics as such. I call it the Holy Land of Earth's Our Land. Okay? And the politics, I can't help that nor solve that. I said earlier in this talk, we need modern day prophets. What are our problems today? We mentioned the problems in ancient Israel. What are our problems today, tell me?
Same.
The same. Be specific. Because I'm going to challenge you and say they're worse. Worse.
Trust in military power.
Yeah, that's a form of idolatry. You know, I sometimes, you know, muck around on YouTube and I like to look at those military, you know, clips, you know, US military power 2016, Chinese military power, Russian military power, and some, especially with the American ones, when I look at them, I go, wow. But I have to remind myself, hold on, this is meaningless. You know, in the eyes of God, this type of military power can be eclipsed overnight, really. And the United States did not win in Korea and lost in Vietnam was because God wasn't going to let them win those wars through their own military might. He had another way to stop the spread of communism, and we weren't listening to it at those times. You know? He wasn't going to allow the West to beat the Soviet Union and communism through our own strength. What other problems we have? Much worse than that.
Sexuality.
Yeah, sexual revolution. Bernard can give a talk in the future on that. We could go for weeks about the sexual revolution. It's the most devastating, the most destructive revolution in the history of the world, and it's deliberately, consciously, and systematically destroying the Jesus revolution. The Jesus revolution is about fidelity, it's about authentic love, it's about sacrifice, it's about marriage, it's about children, it's about staying married, it's about don't commit adultery in your heart or whatever, and the sexual revolution is absolutely destroying this systematically, step by step. You mean you can't even say, I'm a man, I'm male, my gender, I'm male, that's how God made me. That is extremism, that is alternative right extremism, what I just said. That's how mad you have become, yes.
Just a question. You mentioned authentic love. Is that, by your definition, the same as unconditional love?
Yes, and sacrificial love too. You know, the big lie that's happened, the big lie of the sexual revolution is that sex equals love. Their type of sex is just using each other. Mutual using. And discarding as I see you. Once I'm bored with your body, I'll move on. And we do that to each other, and we call that love. That's the great one.
Abortion.
You know, 55 million people died in the Second World War. We go, and we should go. That was 3% of the world's population at the time. We kill 50 million plus every year silently. We call it abortion, and we use a euphemism to disguise that. We call it women's rights or pro-choice. These are lies. These are slogans. They're lies. And you know what? We need a prophet just for this battle. just for the pro-life battle, let alone the other massive battles, just for this battle alone is worthy of prophets. And, you know, I wish Elijah comes back with his eyes on fire and his sword and goes up to Mount Carmel and fights this battle in the way he fought the priests of Baal. That would be phenomenal. But that's what it deserves. You know what irks me is that we've got people in and outside of the church who say, don't be a cultural warrior. This is not important, this battle. We'll fight for refugees. We'll fight for the environment. Okay? We'll fight for, you know, against Donald Trump and his war. Right? But we won't fight about abortion. Because that's cultural war. What other problems do we have? Yes.
Euthanasia.
Euthanasia, yes.
Islamization of Europe.
Don't say that. You must be a Trump supporter. You've probably got a red hat that says, mate, thanks, downgraded. Yeah.
Trying to colonize Mars.
Colonize what?
Mars.
Oh, well. Do you mind if I say that's not really a big problem?
I
go, waste the money. Hollywood, that's a huge problem, isn't it? Corrupts the world.
Yeah,
media. Media corrupts the world. You see, I'm not going to stand in front of you and say, look, I'm a Trump supporter. I'm not going to say that because I think there are big problems with Donald Trump, but there are elements of Donald Trump I agree with, and there are elements of Donald Trump I don't agree with. If I lived in the year 315, I would have said the same thing about Constantine. I think Donald Trump serves our Christian cause in many ways, but in other ways not so. Okay? But one thing I enjoy him doing is calling out the media. Because they do lie. And they do have an agenda, and their agenda is anti-Christian, anti-white, anti-male, anti-father, anti-children, anti-marriage, and it goes on and on and on. Yeah,
all these things that we just said are big problems these days, the media pushes all of those.
And they can't handle it. This politician, this loony crackpot, is having to go at them all the time. Yes?
Do you think that, speaking of Constantine, that Constantinople's belief that Mary was protecting Constantinople, is that superstition?
It could be, not necessarily. It's not black and white. It's superstition if you're saying, it's superstition if I'm wearing a rosary, if I'm wearing a miraculous medal, if I'm wearing a brown scapular, I'm presuming that's going to get me to heaven while I break the Ten Commandments. Okay? That's presumption based on a superstition. Giving too much power to something that doesn't have that power. Okay? So, you know, Constantinople fell eventually. Why? Well, it's a very complex question. It's held out for 8 centuries. It fell. We'll have to ask God why it fell. You have to ask the United States why they would not give it to, why they let it stay in Turkey's hands after World War I. It was Woodrow Wilson who vetoed the idea of making the Bosphorus and the Dardanelles and Constantinople international city not part of Turkey. Because, my goodness, what was the Gallipoli campaign all about? It was all about taking Constantinople and relieving Russia. And Russia wanted Constantinople to make it a Christian city again. Am I right or wrong? That's what it was. Yeah. Anyway. Okay, so I think we've named the big issue, and we haven't named them all.
How's this? Clergy corruption.
Of course. Look at that. You know, you read the Old Testament, and you see so many corrupt priests, and you go, wow, you know what? In the Catholic Church today, it's really always been this bad. It's always been bad. Now, I don't want to denigrate the clergy per se. That's outrageous. Now we've found that 7% of clergy in Australia were pedophiles. And it's a plague across the whole Western world. You know, it doesn't exist among Maronites and Melkites and Middle Eastern clergy anywhere near the extent. So So I'm not going to go into the very complex reasons as to why. But that is a scourge. And it's not just the corruption of the clergy. It's the whole crisis in the church. I was at an event today where a senior priest, what he said was total heresy.
What is that? What is that?
He was advocating for women priests. It's heresy. Now, that doesn't make me popular to say that, you know, because I'm like, there he goes again, misogyny, male domination, narrow-minded, right-wing, conservative, all this, you know, probably speaks in Latin, prays in Latin as well. Okay. Well, you know, no, this is a 2,000 tradition of the church, 2,000-year tradition of the church.
Did they even say something like that about the bishop's approval?
Of course, yeah. I was thinking exactly the same thing.
Isn't that something that can be excommunicated?
Yeah, well, the discipline has gone out. But look, we've got a general sense of the problems. So we desperately need prophets today. If a prophet's going to rise up to deal with these issues in the world, in politics, in society, in culture, take on Hollywood, take on the media, take on political parties, ideologies, take on the corruption, which is they will be persecuted. And that will be a sign that they're authentic prophets. If they're celebrated and cheered and clapped like this priest today, they're a false prophet. If they're taking money, they're a false prophet. There are many, since the 60s, there's been an explosion of alleged apparitions, locutions, people claiming to hear voices, take down messages, see visions. What do? Be a healthy skeptic. Don't run after these things. Run after what the church has always offered. Authentic doctrine, the scriptures, the apostolic tradition, the formal teachings of the church, prayer life, the sacraments, spiritual reading, good companionship. Go after that. Don't go after, oh, this woman's seeing this. Let's go visit her house. St. Charles' statue bleeding. Let's run there. Some of this could be real. And I'm not the one to say yay or nay. It's the bishops. They have the authority. But if you encounter this, good people, enthusiastic people run after these things because they're looking for leadership. They're looking for authenticity. They're looking for something true, divine, real. They want to touch God. They want God to touch them so I can understand it and it's that part of it is authentic. But don't go running after people who claim. Test the spirits. That's what Scripture says. Test the spirits. Watch, observe. Healthy skepticism, meaning don't run after it immediately, but don't condemn it outright. It's the church, formally, that will condemn it outright or prove it outright. Like, for example, I believe in La Salle, I believe in Guadalupe, I believe in Lourdes, I believe in Fatima, I believe in all these apparitions. I personally don't believe in Medjugorje, but some of my best friends, very devout people, they believe in Medjugorje. So I'm not, look, I say, personally, I don't believe it. But so many people, their lives have changed because of Medjugorje. And things do happen there. There are graces there. The church is there. Conversions are there. So I'm not going to condemn it. I don't have a right to condemn it. It's not for me to do that. And then I wait for the church to make that decision. And if the church was to approve it, I would support it. And the church was to say, no, it's not from God. I'll say, well, okay, I thought so, but they're the ones who decided, not me. There are many Protestant end times prophets. And this is why I say prophets of doom, should we listen to them? Because when I was growing up, my conversion was through Protestantism. That's why I got this DVD that no one buys at that, called How Billy Graham Made Me Catholic. Because when I was 15, I went to the Billy Graham Crusader Brandon Grace course. And it was there that I committed myself to Jesus Christ through my Baptist friends. But I always wanted to be a Catholic and stay a Catholic. I just didn't have the answers for years. I was confused. I'd go to the Baptist church, go to their services so I could still play for their cricket team. Okay, but I had no idea. And I'd hear all the things against the Catholic faith and the Pope and Catholic teaching, and I had no answers. But the Protestants that I associated with, good people, really good people, you know, holy people, virtuous people, scriptural people, they were big on the end times prophecies. You know, it's 1979, it's 1980, it's 1981. You know, we've got wars in Afghanistan, Iran-Iraq war, Iranian revolution, the Soviet Union, the United States in decline, blah, blah, all this everywhere, Olympic boycott. You know, and then we're hearing, you know, the second coming. It's going to come 40 years after the foundation of the state of Israel. The rapture's going to come. I'm hearing all these things. I'm thinking, well, why should I study? Why should I do the HSC? Why should I go to the university? This is what I was thinking. And this is where prophets of doom can be dangerous. And this is why we have to be careful and discern the spirits. If I listened to those prophets of doom, I would have walked out and gone and kept that job that I had at Johnson Evan Root on Canterbury Road, working in the factory making outboard marine engines. I wouldn't have gone to university. Right? Okay, I wouldn't have been a teacher. I wouldn't be where I am today. Not that I'm great, I'm not, but I'm something rather than nothing. I wouldn't have been able to contribute to building the kingdom of God in any way, shape, or form if I listened to those prophets of doom at the time. Those that you know are warning about the evils of this time and giving real positive solutions. Pray, penance, keep doing what you're doing. People ask me regularly now, the church is in a bad state, there's confusion everywhere. What are we meant to do? Keep doing what you've been doing. Keep praying, keep going to Mass, keep going to confession. Keep teaching the faith where you are. Keep raising your children for God. Keep obeying the commandments. Keep doing good and avoiding evil. Keep doing what you're doing. That's the solution. Oh, I'm thinking, I told my wife the other day, I've got to go to Costco and stack up. You know, what if a war breaks out? Donald Trump and all that. Look, it's not going to help me. Being faithful, that's what it is. What else do we say? Avoid despair, avoid isolationism, be really realistic. Hopeful, I'll end on this note. A prophet is authentic, another sign of authenticity. If they're a prophet of doom, is that they're also a prophet of hope. They don't believe it's just that they're doom. God is still in control. That's the hope. Jesus Christ will come again. That's the hope. The church will never be destroyed. That's the hope. And so if you're listening to a doom and gloom prophet and they conclude that, you know, we're going to win in the end, fear not, persevere, well, listen to that prophet. That prophet of doom is more likely to be a true one than a false one. Okay, well, on that note, I'll leave it at that. Thank you for your patience.